This time last week, when news of Nelson Mandela's death started travelling around the internet and around the world, I had a bit of a reaction against the reaction, the popular reaction. Yes, it was sad to see that man pass away, and I mourned like everybody else did the loss of a great man. But I had an issue with the way he was being portrayed, which wasn't really, when I think back and impassionately, it wasn't really anything to do with Nelson Mandela himself or how he was being portrayed. It was about the way we in general tend to gloss over the ugly parts of our heroes. I'm quoting a phrase I came up with last week that I kind of liked. That's to offset another phrase I came up with that I completely abhor. I had a sort of a point in my objections, and it was to do with that. Look, let's, just because somebody's dead doesn't mean we can just ignore everything they did and, you know, all the ugly parts and focus only on the good parts. So it was the refrain of Nelson Mandela: he was a great man, he was a man of peace. And this man of peace thing kind of gnawed away at me. It doesn't tell the whole story. It didn't tell the whole story. The time wasn't right, perhaps, to be bringing it up. A little bit insensitive of me there. But it was the way in which I what bothered me in the aftermath of all that was not that I was insensitive at the time, or that I had a bad point to make. My real problem was the way in which I made my point. Outside of YouTube, I only really take part in one other online forum. It's on Facebook. It's an atheist forum on Facebook. And somebody there posted a quote from Mandela from earlier this year when he was praising Che Guevara. Now, the guy who posted this tends to post these kind of... he's got Che Guevara as his avatar for a start. So he was getting denounced on the forum for being off topic. Like, what's this got to do with atheism? Which is fair enough. But I jumped in, took the opportunity and said, well, look, neither Che Guevara nor Nelson Mandela are the saints they're being portrayed as. They both have their negative sides. And that grew in then to a bit of a debate, and I was the only one who had anything negative to say. And I don't know whether I reacted because I was being backed into a corner. I don't remember feeling that way. I rarely do. I feel that way. But here's something I wrote. This is what's been troubling me for the last week. I said in one of the posts, one of the comments I made, I can't remember it now, I haven't looked at it in the last 4 or 5 days, I can't bring myself to even, I haven't even gone back to that forum since. I said something along the lines of, Nelson Mandela can't be given the credit for taking down the apartheid system in South Africa. Okay, pause, let that sink in. Here you. Sorry. Yeah, swing away from me. And it got worse. I said worse things than that. Now, I had a point to make, and it seemed to me in hindsight, when I was reading back in those comments later on that night, that I was willing to just pluck things out of thin air so long as they supported my point. I can't plead ignorance. I'm not an expert on that situation, but I lived through it. I can remember the time very clearly. And I do know a little bit of his participation, his crucial participation in that process. He wasn't the only one, for sure. He brought about the ceasefire shortly after his release, he didn't take violence off the table. He made a comment about his, when things were stalling and he couldn't get the government to do something about the kind of death squads that were going around. He made a flippant comment about temporary ceasefires being temporary. Let's not forget that, what he said, which was mirrored a year later by Gerry Adams here in the north of Ireland, when he said about the IRA, they haven't gone away, you know. There's obviously subtleties to the political situation that I wasn't taking into account, or I wasn't willing to take into account, because it kind of interfered with the point I was trying to make, that look, just because he achieved some great things, let's not turn him into Saint Nelson. Now, I left off, I had exchanged a couple of comments on that forum. It was late at night, and I left off and I switched over to YouTube. And I got into a small exchange on a thread for Jeff Heisenberg, his video. He was like an RIP Nelson Mandela type of thing. And I carried it on there. Now, luckily for me, I can rely on the people, my friends here on YouTube, to call me on my bullshit. Oh, excuse me, the hand's falling off me. And Laura Layla came to my rescue and kind of pointed out the subtleties that I was ignoring. Thank you, Laura Layla. And it was then, only then, after her intervention, that I kind of rolled back on my rhetoric and said, well, look, it's not actually Nelson Mandela I have a problem with. It's this sanctifying of public figures that goes on. Because the danger in it, I was seeing, Nelson Mandela has been he was a figurehead for that anti-apartheid movement, the freedom movement. And it's largely down to his input and the symbolism of the man that the ANC has managed to hold power there ever since he was released, basically. Well, a couple of years after his release, 94, 95, whenever he was first elected. Yeah, they've been in power ever since. And they're not a great government. Anybody knows, they're not particularly good, and there's a lot of criticisms to be made of the ANC. It's not the point of this video, really. The point of this video is to criticise myself. So several hours later, about 5 or 6 in the morning then, after those few exchanges and after being calmed down and brought to my senses by Laura Layla, I went back and I read the Facebook exchange. I went back to see if what anybody had said. And of course, 2 or 3 people had piped in, calling what I'd written the most revisionist nonsense they'd ever heard. One guy said, look, it seemed to him like I was trying too hard to be clever. And he was dead right. That's exactly what I was doing. I was trying far too hard to be clever. And in the attempt, I'd completely ignored reality because it wasn't convenient at that time. I didn't agree with what I'd written. And I had to make an embarrassing apology. Apology shouldn't be embarrassing, but yeah, I was embarrassed for having written in the first place. But I had to just, you know, there's no, even though I had a point to make, a valid point to make, I had to just discard that, because, you know, what I'd written, and that's only the tip of the iceberg. I'd written some other things. There's only 2 or 3 posts we're talking about, but I do tend to ramble on in posts and videos, so they're quite long. Jeez, my arm's falling off me here now. I need to get a better steady cam. Sorry for waving around like that. I read back. So 4 or 5 in the morning, 5 or 6, whatever it was, several hours later, I went back and I read it. And I really could not believe what I had written. I was mortified, really. So I made an apology, and it was 3 people. The group has only about 2,000 members. And like all forums, of those 2,000 members, it's only a couple dozen who regularly contribute and take part. But of those, only 3 had bothered to take me up on it. Now, not everybody reads every post on every thread, on every forum. But I was surprised that only three had. And I apologised to all three of those people. And thanked them in the end. You know, that's what you have to do. You have to thank people for pointing out your errors. But afterwards, or the last week, I've been wondering, why did I do it? It's not that I held those opinions. They're not my views. And I did. Look, I went back a few hours later, I went back and I read it and I retracted. I retracted what I'd said. But I... And so the checks and balances, you know, that of somebody who is supposed to be arguing from a reasonable point of view or a rational point of view, back failure and I retracted. So the system works, but not well enough. I thought I should have caught that as I was making the comment. But as I was making the comment, it just did not occur to me. So I don't know. I spent a week thinking about it. And here I am apologising to the ether. Because none of you people watching this video have likely read those posts. But it's troubling, don't you think? I certainly think it is. I'm trying to figure out where it came from. Is it perhaps, do we get too used to arguing here on the internet? Arguing for the sake of argument. Being blinkered. It's the same kind of unprincipled error that I would take somebody up on myself. I would pounce on them. If I was a stranger reading my post, I would have pounced on me. And those three guys, none of them pounced on me. They politely pointed out my errors. Well, slightly more than politely pointed out my errors. All right, Sam, don't worry. I'm not ignoring you. Drop the ball. I can't throw it if you don't drop it. I don't know where else to go with this. I kind of asked people's advice. It seemed more relevant to me because a week before that, I had made a video about Desert File, criticising him for the way he behaved. And a lot of people subsequently to me releasing that video got in touch, some of them in PMs, and said, look, you know, he's a good dude, you know. He's people I trust, people I respect, and whose opinion I definitely take on board. Said, look, no, this is... I'm sure when he comes back, he's going to straighten that all out. It's not what he's like. And I said, fair enough. And he did. In all fairness to him, Desert File came back and he made a completely unequivocal and unambiguous apology. So I took down that video because it kind of felt mean. Well, it was mean to have it on there. But I criticised him, and there's me doing something, not the exact same, but not far off it. You know, here was me willing to ignore a glaring fact in order to make my point, which is, not a million miles away from what Desert File did. So pot calling the kettle black, that was me, really. Walk away, I'm talking to these people. Sorry. He can almost hear me, you know. Or almost understand me. Should have just lost my train of thought there. Yeah. That video was kind of argumentative. I wasn't particularly fond of it. There was a couple of points I liked that I wouldn't mind developing on, but the bits where I was attacking him were a little bit mean, and I was trying to do it, trying to show how pointless, well, not pointless, or how easily distracted you can be by your argument, by your style of argument, and somehow miss the argument you're making. And I debated over removing that video. This is all tied up with principles and ethics, isn't it, really? I debated over whether to take that video down because it got quite a lot of views for a video of mine. You know, it got at least twice as many views as a video of mine would normally get. And it had some particularly good comments underneath it. I was really surprised by the response. People responded well to it. And because it was a video harping on about principles, I was really happy to see people in the comment section volunteering their own apologies, saying, well, look, yeah, that's made me think about things a bit more now. That's more than you can expect, really, from most videos. I got a fairly considerable bump in subscribers off that video. And I thought, well, two things happening here. What am I up to here now? How far am I going? 16 minutes, okay. I can edit that down. Yeah, I got a bump in subscribers, and I thought, well, these people are going to think that this is representative, which is not really. It's not my style of video. Also, they subscribed pretty much because of that video, and therefore I just removed the video that had attracted them to my channel in the first place. And I thought long and hard about removing it. I didn't actually remove it, I just made it unlisted. And then, this is rambling, I'm going off point here, but fuck it. Fred, conference report, was kind of critical, not particularly of me, but of that idea in general of self-censorship. Well, look, it means you're taking something away from the record. How are digital anthropologists of the future supposed to unpick these kind of situations if the data isn't there for them? Now, the video has been available on my UDoubled account. I'll leave a link for that down below. But because it's unlisted now, I'm going to leave a link to it in the description box of this video. Primarily because of those comment streams. There were some interesting comments and conversations that happened underneath the video. But I don't want to be distributing it, so I'm not going to I'm going to disable ratings, and I'm going to leave comments as for unapproval, and I'm not going to approve any new comments to it. I don't want to. It's unfair to Desert File to be spreading it around again, but to take Fred's example and to preserve the record, I'll do that. So there's a few things for people to mull over. How easily are we distracted from our points? Or how much are we willing to give up in order to make a point? There's the question. I behaved in the way that disappointed me in order to make a point that certainly could have been made several days later and 1,000 times better. Also, what else can we have to think about that there? Yeah. What do you think about this preserving even our failures? I could have deleted those posts on that forum on Facebook. I could have just gone in there and deleted them. But no, you have to kind of take humble pie. Or swallow humble pie, is that it? No. Swallow your pride. I'm mixing my metaphors up here, I'm getting completely lost. No, I have to leave them there. You have to own your mistakes. That's why, no, I haven't been back to that forum in about 4 or 5 days. I felt really bad because I don't know what my reputation on that forum is, or if that's not really important, but yeah, my credibility. That's the key. My credibility took a dint. In the eyes of those people that I do like to communicate with, but most importantly, my credibility took a dent in my own eyes. And that's far more important. So, I'll leave it at that. I think this dog is looking forward to getting a walk. Oh, okay. Bye-bye.